What's up, people? JDub here with another edition of my weekly top 5 for the world of wrestling. Before we get started with this video, make sure to follow me on Twitter as I constantly post updates on everything that's going on within the PWF empire, and it's also the easiest way to interact with me and post topic suggestions for things to talk about on PWTR and in videos like this. And that's twitter.com/JDubShow. Now that that's out of the way, let's move on to our first story. WWE recently underwent a corporate restructuring that named Stephanie McMahon as a new chief brand officer. Now that's a promotion from her previous position as head of the creative team, and she was replaced by an interesting individual to say the least. The person that replaced her? None other than her husband, Triple H. For years, Triple H has talked about the value in WWE's developmental system and how vital it was to the company's future. Then, what happens? We get the Performance Center and also the revamped NXT. And in so many interviews that I've seen from him over the years, he's always spoke of wanting to see a resurgence in the tag team division. And that's coming to fruition also. So it'll be interesting to see if we get some huge overhaul in the creative process, because it's clear that he's already had a growing influence within the company. And all this move likely does is just solidify and make official something that has already been in the works behind the scenes. I'm hoping that this change is more than just a symbolic one, where all Triple H is a figurehead that imposes the will of the McMahons, because if that's the case, then what the hell is the point of Stephanie vacating the position in the first place? This needs to be a real changing of the guard, and one thing that Triple H does have working in his favor, it seems as if he has a different philosophy on how things are supposed to go. He's not afraid to rock the boat, he's not afraid to shake some shit up, because one thing that I cannot stand is complacency. This may not be working, but this is the way that it has been, and this is the way that it's gonna be. Triple H, he doesn't seem to subscribe to that belief. If it's something that needs an overhaul, it needs to be reinvigorated, he's gonna look at that, examine it, see what's working, what's not working, and put in that work, put in that effort to make it efficient. Just look at the tag team division, look at WWE developmental. So if Triple H is going to create this overhaul for WWE, looking at those different components of the company and then bringing them all together for an overall great picture, here are a few things that I'm going to be looking for. What was done with the tag team division, do that for the mid-card, please. Please, the elements, they are there. You have talented individuals ready to take the world by storm. But the problem is, 99.999% of the feuds that they're featured in are so dull and uninspiring that no one gives a crap. Look at Cody Rhodes' Goldust versus The Shield. Great storyline to show just how much they hated each other, and in turn, that added more importance to the tag team titles. That's the way it's supposed to be done. You can't have a feud with no heat that's just centered around the mid-card championships, because the titles don't mean anything in the first fucking place. A few months ago, Dean Ambrose said that as a United States champion, he was the baddest man on the planet, even above the two world champions at the time. Now, even though that went nowhere, and even though we all know that that was some straight up bullshit, the point is, that moment was amazing, and that's how the title should be handled going forward. Instead of telling us who used to hold the titles, make us remember the fact that you're holding it right now. My next suggestion, cut the bullshit. Plain and simple, not every match needs to end with a screwy finish. Of course, they have their place in wrestling from time to time, but that is not supposed to be the standard. Sometimes the best option isn't to go for shot value, it's just to deliver a definitive winner. And finally, work with what you have. Over the last few years, we've developed this policy of bringing in part-timers like The Rock, Brock Lesnar, and even The Undertaker and Triple H, as they aren't fully active members of the roster. And these guys eat up so much time when it comes to building towards their matches. Now realize, I'm not saying that what we get as a result from all of them isn't good, because I really enjoy seeing each and every one of them on my TV. But the point is, they're not on my TV wrestling in matches that much. You exert all of this creative effort to guys who aren't even around for 90% of the year while throwing everyone else scraps. I'm not saying get rid of them, but what I am saying is don't forget to elevate the people who are going to be there for you day in and day out. Treat them as if they're important too. Otherwise, what happens when Brock Lesnar and The Rock leave? You specifically brought them on to bring interest back to your company. But guess what? If you don't give people a reason to stay, when they leave, that interest is going to leave also. Those fans, that money, they're going to follow their ass right out of the door. So you have to bust your ass to deliver those meaningful feuds and matches for the people who are actually on the roster. So you can put yourself in a position that says, hey, I came for Brock Lesnar and The Rock, but I'm staying for Dolph Ziggler, CM Punk, Daniel Bryan, Big E Langston, so on and so forth. Whoever you want to throw on that list. And looking over 2013, I really have a problem with the WWE feuds and those big match feels, because they're far and few between. They really haven't done that this year. And some of the names that we can throw on that list, the funny thing is, they involve all of the fucking part-timers. That's my point exactly. You got to give stuff to the people who are going to be there for you week after week after week. It seems as if they're kind of sort of trying to do that at the very last minute with Orton and Cena. And as much as I'm enjoying that one, I still have issues with that, because I don't like the way that the match was booked. It wasn't organic. And that's something that really needs to change in WWE. And I'm hoping that they work on that going forward. Let's switch gears over to SmackDown now. CM Punk versus Dean Ambrose and the simmering tension within the Shield that came along with that match were some of the highlights of the show for me. Roman Reigns, he was displaying signs of cockiness when it came to determining who was the best member of the Shield to face Punk. But Rollins and Ambrose, they brought him back down to earth, and Dean even leapfrogged right over him and declared himself as the top dog in the Hounds of Justice. I'm looking for Ambrose and Rollins to have expanded roles as the Shield goes forward, and slowly but surely, it looks as if that is happening. The goal for them is to continue developing their characters while not dimming the spotlight on Roman Reigns. Now, there's a delicate balance that WWE has to strike here, and they've been pretty good with the Shield thus far, so I'm going to have confidence in them that that is going to continue. Also, the main event of Daniel Bryan and Randy Orton was a nice match, but I just hate the way that the match was set up, and it really exposes a flaw in the concept of SmackDown. The opening segment was so contrived and out of fucking nowhere. They would have been better off just having Daniel Bryan come out there and say, oh, hey, you know, Orton, I was roaming around bored backstage and I just happened to see your face on a monitor and I remembered that we were in a feud where you screwed me out of the WWE Championship. Now, I know that was a few months ago and I should have been pissed off about it then, but I'm really pissed off about it right now. And what a coincidence that we don't have a main event for SmackDown tonight. So, you know, what do you say? Me and you in the ring one-on-one tonight. Shit, he may as well have came out and said that, because at least that would have been honest. I just can't get over the feeling that SmackDown is the equivalent of a person shopping at a thrift shop. Sometimes you're hunting, looking for a come up, and you find one, but most of the times, it's just Monday Night Raw's old ratty ass acid wash jeans. In the eyes of creative, as long as there is no brand extension, SmackDown will always be at the mercy of the A-Show. Nothing important is ever going to happen there, and anything that's close to an important storyline is only supplemental, meaning you don't even have to watch the show and you won't miss out on anything at all. Sure, you'll get some good matches, but you'll be lucky if they have any purpose to them. Now, as far as I've seen, that is not a problem with our next topic of discussion, NXT. I know with the mess that we were delivered on Sci-Fi a few years ago with the NXT competition show, those three letters have a stigma attached to them, but I kid you not, it's been completely revamped since then. This is basically another WWE brand, but the interesting thing about this one is that it features developmental talent, and we frequently get appearances from superstars on the main roster, so this is like an indie promotion with that big money backing, and that works very well in their favor. Now, I've only watched the last two episodes of NXT, but I have honestly loved every bit of them. And just my luck that I started watching in the midst of a tournament to determine a number one contender for the NXT Championship. I've already seen some great matches, two of them featuring this character named Adrian Neville, who ended up as a number one contender winning the tournament. And this dude is friggin' amazing. And he actually has a moniker, the man that gravity forgot. And if you watch his matches and his in-ring action, it definitely lends credence to that. Some other notes, on the last episode, we got an awesome title match between NXT Women's Champion Paige and her challenger Natalya, which was the best Divas match by far that I've seen in a long time. And On the main roster, I actually judge the Divas at a lower standard because they're just so bad, I refuse to go out there and say every fucking match sucks. So that's where you get the phrase from me, it was good for a Divas match. But they don't deserve that title here. This was a fucking good match, period. Point blank, period. End of discussion. You can judge them at the regular standard, and they still went above and beyond that. So kudos to both of them. And from one champion to another, the NXT champion, Bo Dallas, he's questionable. Now, I will say that it can go either way, whether I like him or dislike him, it can go either way. But for people like Adrian Neville, Sami Zayn, Paige, they immediately caught my interest straight off the bat. Like, bam, as soon as I saw them for a few minutes, I was like, okay, I like this person. But the jury is still out on him. Going back to my original point, you get high impact action on the show with great matches. And not just that, but the matches actually have meaning attached to them. There's no wasted motion, barely any filler on the show at all. And after watching just two episodes, I already feel as if I'm caught up, while at the very same time, not feeling overwhelmed. So that means that the show is very easy to get into. And if you haven't been tuning in, starting next week, we're going to be carrying episodes of NXT over on PWF Empire, so I highly suggest that you check it out. So, we have the Slammies coming up in the next episode of Monday Night Raw. The Slammies have been fun from time to time, but I friggin' hate when WWE schedules these themed episodes of Raw on the last show before pay-per-views. They just did it with the country episode of Raw leading into Survivor Series, and they're doing it again here. Now, instead of being hokey and doing stupid ass comedy bits, I would imagine that you have more important things to do and better ways to spend your time, especially seeing as at your next pay-per-view you have a match that you're declaring as one of the biggest matches in history. You would kind of think that you wouldn't want that conflict there, the seriousness over here and the stupid shit going on over there, but hey, whatever. I guess I do understand why it is done, though. It's basically WWE conceding to the belief that fans are more likely to tune in because of a gimmick than they are to tune in to see build to a pay-per-view. And if that is the case, to quote Clay Davis, that's some shameful shit. But onward and upward, another award show that we're looking forward to is the Dubbies. Yes, they are making a return. The Dubbies, aka the PWF Empire Awards, are our year-end awards for wrestling. The ceremony will be held on a live edition of Pro Wrestling Talk Radio in the first week of January. But before we get there, we're going to need your help. Right below this post on PWF Empire is a list of all of the categories for the Dubbies. We want to make sure we don't forget anything or anyone when it comes to the nominations, so make sure you let us know your suggestions in the comment section down below. The final list of nominations will be announced on PWTR, not this week, but next week, along with a special segment dedicated to the PWTR hosts ranting, rating, and debating, and stating our cases for who we think should win the awards. Speaking of PWTR, last week's show featured one of the most heated debates in PWTR history. And on top of that, Charlie just released a column on PWF Empire where he takes aim at our fellow co-host Justin. There have been so many more instances of the co-host butting heads, and that got me to thinking. And the result of that process will be a new segment debuting on the next episode of PWTR titled Shots Fired. In addition to our TLC preview, we're going to have the segment Shots Fired that will pit host against host in a showdown of epic proportions. The battle lines have been drawn and we're going to war. Which side will end up victorious? Make sure you check out the next episode of PWTR to find out. Our fifth and final story. As we get closer to TLC, the build for the champion versus champion match continues to heat up. On Raw, we had a great war of words with John Cena and Randy Orton leading into a brawl that showcased just what to expect in their tables, ladders, and chairs match. Picking up off of last week's discussion, we actually got a guarantee that there is only going to be one man to walk out of TLC as the undisputed champion. And Triple H solidified that guarantee in his weekly sit-down with Michael Cole. Roll it.
This is the biggest thing that's happened in a long, long time. And I think this is going to be one of these moments that happen every now and then that are remembered forever. You know, this TLC match between John Cena and Randy Orton to determine who is the champion will be remembered forever. And I guarantee you, when TLC pay-per-view is over, we will have one champion. The King of Kings will crown the Champion of Champions.
Is it just me, or did that scare the shit out of anyone else? It's just the way that he formed that. The King of Kings, the Champion of Champions. It makes it seem as if he's going to have his hand in how the match ends. But, see now, Triple H, I need you to resist your natural inclination to do anything twisted up in this here play. You feel me? That aside, back to the competitors. I talked about this last week on WTF, my issue with Randy Orton and him lacking consistency. I said that he was back on track, but here we go again. I was so ready to come on here and praise him for breaking away from the authority and establishing his independence. He even went as far as to say that all of the men who have ever held the world titles, he's better than all of them. Not only that, he looked Triple H in his eyes, in the windows of his soul, and said, "Bitch," no, he didn't say that. He said, "I'm better than all of them, including you." Amazing, amazing. But fast forward to SmackDown, and what does he do? He apologizes. Are you fucking serious? Really? He went from a bad ass to an ass kisser, and for what? What did we get out of that segment? Seriously. That added absolutely nothing to the storyline, and if it had happened on Raw, I would really be pissed off right now. But since it happened on SmackDown, it doesn't matter, so who cares? Back to Raw, Orton using the crowd's hatred of Cena to his advantage, and also him saying that he was put on this earth with one mission, and that was to make sure John Cena lost the biggest match of his life. That was all great, and as far as Cena goes, you don't hear too often about one of the most decorated talents within a profession being referred to as a disappointment for not achieving even more than what they already have. But the fact that John Cena took that line of attack, and not only that, he made sense of it, that was really impressive. Randy Orton, he was a chosen one, and he was groomed to be the guy, but John Cena took that position from him, and now he's set on taking the Undisputed Championship from him too. They really went all out with this segment, and I'm wondering how the hell they're going to top this on Monday Night Raw. I have no idea, but one thing that I do know, they damn sure better do it, because each and every week the stakes for this match get higher and higher, and they hype it up more and more. All of the history connected to these two championships, and this is a match of epic proportions, one of the biggest matches, quite possibly the biggest match in WWE history. Okay, we'll see. We definitely shall see. So I'm hoping that the final sell for this match, and also the match itself, they deliver. And yeah, I'll be tuning in to see it, and you can guarantee I'll be right back here to let you know exactly what I thought about it. So thank you guys for tuning into this video. Let me know your thoughts on all the things that I discussed in this video down in the comment section below. And if you have any suggestions as to what I should talk about in the next WTF, go ahead and shoot them my way. As for now, I am J-Dub, and I'm out of here. Peace.